See, we took up the issue of the search for contributors. Okay. Okay. We have recognized the contributors, but we have to fix it, actually. Okay. is something similar to this. Oh, the wave function has been recognized because it is all good calculations, everything is giving good answers. But we don't know what exactly it is, something is happening. Okay? Like that. So it will have to be fixed. So, how is it getting fixed? Because we have seen that the very cause is characterized by the absence of the effect. Okay? And this applies to ultimate cause also. Therefore, we want to exclude all the exclusive features of the effects. Okay? Now, the exclusive features are grouped in three entities. And the chain, inertia, and the limitedness. Okay? Notice here, remember this. All finiteness and inertia, okay, damage effects. But they are sealing the effects. What is the effect? The effect is one which is produced. Okay. But inertia and finiteness, they are not produced. In produced objects, they are seen. Okay. Therefore, they have to be considered as independent. Okay. Because we have seen there are effects. Some of them are inert, some of them are not inert. An object is produced, it is inert. But its understanding is also produced. But that is not inert. Therefore, inertia we cannot take as produced, it is not an effect. Similarly, rootedness also. Now, a stone is also produced, ether is also produced. But ether is unlimited, stone is limited. Therefore, limitedness is also not a produced entity. Not produced. It appears. Therefore, now we have taken these three features. Now we show that these three features are mutually independent. Okay. Now here there is a precise checking that. Somehow this inertia and limitedness, they go together. Because they are mental constructs, no? Because they are not observed. You know, perhaps what in the beginning? Mass is a construct. Because two bodies with the same velocity will carry higher momentum. Momentum is something that we can understand, we can experience. Whereas mass we can't experience. Therefore, mass is construct. Okay. Force is constructed. Okay? Therefore, all these mental thoughts are somehow how exactly they are different from effects, produced effects. It is a lot of things to be clarified. Remaining. Okay. Now that apart. Now, because these are all the observable features, and they are mutually independent. If we exclude all these three, then the ultimate cause will get fixed. Okay? Now, for instance, by negation of these features, see, from the point of view of physics, I would say. Point of physics. We have already seen that the quantum system is not measurable. It's a probability system. Okay. Now, we know its existence through what? Schrodinger's wave function is there. We make calculations. Therefore, it is there. Not that it is not simply guessing or anything. It is there. It has to be accepted. But what exactly is it we know? So to know that, how does it proceed? It is a probability field. That is, it is not measurable. Therefore, we have defined the wave function in terms of non-measurability. That is, in classical EEG measurement, you don't have it. It's a negative recognition, not a positive recognition. Okay? In the case of ultimate cause also, it's identical. Namely, we have to define it only negatively. The reason is the following. See, take for instance all the intermediate causes. If you want to know what exactly the intermediate cause is, to destroy the effects, you can catch all effect. That way, you will get the as it is knowledge of an intermediate cause only by destroying the effect. Now, such a thing can't be done in the case of wave function and also in the case of the ultimate cause. You can't destroy the field and know what it is. You can't do that. Okay? Therefore, there is a lot of similarity. It has started from here. See this transition. Up to intermediate causes, the stage is one. It's more or less classical in some sense. Okay. The moment you leave intermediate causes, that is observable intermediate causes, then it is something terribly different. I remember it was earlier. As long as you're sticking to particles, they're all intermediate causes. But the moment you go to a probability field, it is no longer an observable quantity. Therefore, by mental analysis, how can I have to do? Identical is related to the case of ultimate cause. Because ultimate cause is that, okay, which is not an effect. Ultimate cause is something which is not an effect. Now, if you restrict intermediate cause, what happens is you always use inference. Inference, you remember, whatever inference I make, if it is to be valid, the inference is to be valid, then it must be perceptible. Are you remembering this? See, smoke, for example, is there? When I say I smoke, after I conclude that there is fire. When does it get back to validity? It gets back to only when I personally go and see them. This is generally the case of all intermediate causes. Therefore, an intermediate cause is bound to be an effect. And so, only intermediate causes are available for inference. Okay. But, above that if you go, the problem is there. Okay, therefore, now, what is being needed? We want to fix it in this negative way. So, what do we go? We say changelessness. There is change in all observable quantity, change is an observable quantity, therefore, observable feature, therefore, there is no change. That is the definition. No change means what? Every effect is bound to change. Because this problem is getting lost. Therefore, it means it is not at all an effect. Therefore, if you say it is not at all an effect, it must be the cause only. Cause means it's a pristine, pure cause, which is not an effect. All the intermediate causes are not pure. are only intimate causes, because they also themselves get lost. Okay? Therefore, what is the unique feature of the ultimate cause? It is not at all an effect at any stage. It is only the cause. Okay? Now, next thing. Oh, we have to filter out inertia. Now, in the case of inertia, it is not inertia. That is, what actually removes inertia is to be found out. Changelessness removes change. Okay. Similarly, what removes inertia is to be found out. This is a new concept for physics. Therefore, better concentrate on this. Now, inertia means what definition? Definition is something, a body inert, which by its own effort, it cannot change its status. Okay. Generally, it is told, it is necessary to change the force. If you apply force, it will change. Therefore, it appears as though force is the removal of inertia. But now, investigate whether this satisfies the criteria. The force is there. Force, it can be applied, it can be withdrawn. Okay? Therefore, force is generated, also stopped. And that itself, it is not born out of itself, it doesn't get killed by itself. Okay? Now, there is a point of application, direction, and magnitude. It doesn't decide by itself. Therefore, according to the definition of inertia, it is also inert. But you can accept it as an intermediate removal of inertia, as an intermediate cause, you can say. Therefore, what is the ultimate cause for removing inertia? You see. Now, come back. We have seen observable observer. It is only the observer who is changing the status. Therefore, you come here. How does he do? He thinks of the appropriate force and then applies it. Therefore, you have to search for the anti-inertial entity in his thought process. The thought process. Because he gets a thought, okay, this is the object. Now I have to hold it like this and then push it. How subtle it is. If it is an egg, one lifts like this. If it is a heavy object, it lifts like this. Okay. In fact, very subtle difference, minute differences it can think of. Therefore, you get the knowledge to the object and then apply the force. Therefore, considering the knowledge of the object. Okay. Oh, this is big. Knowledge of its bigness. Knowledge of its shape. Okay. Knowledge of the direction in which you want it to go. There are so many knowledges are there. All these knowledge just put together as a resultant, I apply the force. Okay. But these things are also produced. These knowledges are also produced. Therefore, it cannot be a cause. It can also be an intermediate cause. Therefore, let us see whether it is containing something which could be a cause. What is that? Or the knowledge of the size of the body, the knowledge of its shape, the knowledge of which way it has to go. There are so many knowledges. All these knowledges contain the knowledge per se and also an adjective. Knowledge of the size, knowledge of the shape, etc. Therefore, of the shape, of the size, they are all adjectives. And knowledge is common in all of them. Okay? Now, without knowledge, a qualified knowledge cannot arise at all. Without this, a qualified knowledge can never arise. Even this qualified knowledge is not there, that will survive. Rolla said. What is that? It is the ability of thinking. Or if you recognize it, what exactly is this knowledge? It is unqualified knowledge. This unqualified knowledge is precisely the ability to think. All of you recognize this? Therefore, it is this ability through a thought and according to it through a force, it changes the inertia. Therefore, ultimately, which is removing, which is the ultimate cause for the removal of inertia? It is this unqualified knowledge, the ability to produce knowledge, qualified knowledges. Okay. Now this is unchanging, this always exists, there are adjectives in it. Therefore, we say that this knowledge, unqualified knowledge, is the ultimate removal of inertia. It is empty inertia. Therefore, this knowledge is called consciousness. Okay. This is a very precise definition. It is called jnapti. Sometimes it is called prajnapti. It is different from jnana. Jnana means vishesha jnana also, qualified knowledge also is included here. Okay. Therefore, the second CU, what is filtered out is Varshya, by consciousness. Now remember, in the quantum mechanical measurement problem, thought process is involved. What does he do? The experimenter, he knows that the system has given a choice to measure either wave nature or the particle nature. Therefore, he chooses the corresponding apparatus. And the apparatus also he can't put anywhere. He has to put it in a definite place. Okay. Therefore, these thought processes are involved in the problem of measurement. The thought process themselves have been are being called as consciousness. That's why they are missing the point. The point is missed because of this. This thought process is a consequence of consciousness. We'll come to that afterwards. We'll come to it. Therefore, now, in our trying to fix the ultimate cause, we have already filtered down both change and also inertia by satya, changelessness, and jnana, unqualified knowledge, the ability to know things. Okay. Yes.
As soon as this ultimate cause exercises, as soon as the ultimate cause exercises its ability to know something, does it also undergo a change, or what changes when it exercises its ability to know something?
Actually, you have asked an unanswerable question. Okay. I think all of you have heard the question. Okay. If this consciousness, when it decides to do something, you ask, what exactly how the decision is coming around? Now, think out like this. Suppose I am able to guess it. Suppose I am able to guess it. Then, that itself becomes an observer. Are you following me? It's a conclusion thing, no? No, by definition, consciousness is not observable. It is because the ability, see, the ability of knowing is consciousness. Therefore, we can never search for consciousness outside. Are you seeing the point? Please, physics students, please think it over. See, consciousness is the ability. Okay. Now the ability is the primordial cause. Now suppose I make an inference. It has to be verified. If I make an inference, how it is going to be? Then it becomes an observable. Therefore, this question itself is unaskable. Have I conveyed my idea? Shall I repeat it? Shall I repeat? This question that is asked, if I have to answer it, it can only be inference. Is it right? Oh, like this. Therefore, now, when doing inference, what are the things? I must see an indication, like smoke. And then I should be knowing the connection between that and fire. Previously, in my kitchen, I have seen it. Okay. Therefore, inference needs two aspects, two knowledges, namely an indication, which is perceivable, and also its connection with the inferred. Both are necessary in the case of inference. Now, neither there is an indication here. How can I know its connection? The ability doesn't have any indication by itself. Therefore, I can't even know the connection. Therefore, this question is unaskable. Have I understood or not? Please think over it.
So we now have an ultimate cause.
Yes.
Okay, for something like knowledge to come then.
Yes.
Okay, like this ultimate cause should lead to some immediate effect or something like that, right?
Repeat your question.
We now have an ultimate cause.
Yes.
Okay, and everything in the world is actually related to it through
yes.
effects.
Okay.
Okay. The moment we know, since consciousness is the ultimate cause, the moment we know that, let's say I need to change the inertness of something.
Huh?
Let's say I need to change the inertness of something.
Huh.
Okay, so then there should be an immediate effect after that. Right? So, like, what is the effect or something?
Of course. See, now we have got the ability to think. Now we have thought. Okay. Now tell me how this has worked. You go work backwards. Now you heard something in relation to it. What did you do? Oh, I guess something. There is supposed to be an answer, which you are guessing. You are asking it as an objection. Okay. Suppose I have not asked anything. Without my asking you, how can you locate the reason for your ability to think something? What? Are you understanding the depth of discussion? Take for instance the quantum field. Okay. Now quantum field, what guess we can make? When you make a measurement, you don't know what process is there. Therefore, you don't know the connection between smoke and fire. In that example, smoke and fire. Here, you are saying some smoke, some particle is produced. I know that. Okay. But now connection, I don't know the connection. Therefore, as long as I don't know the connection, what can I guess about it? Therefore, is it not impossible for us already to draw by inference what exactly is happening in the quantum wave function? Are you following me? Are you seeing the argument? Please think it over. Therefore, I will come to that. The moment you cross classical mechanics, you are simply confounded by questions. Not one or two. They will simply daze you. If it is happening even in the case of a quantum field, which is the intermediate cause, because it has crossed quantum mechanics, classical mechanics, okay, it is difficult. See, till classical mechanics, inference works. Afterwards, it is very difficult. Now, even that is an intermediate cause, because you know it is produced. You produce a quantum field, is it not so? Therefore, at least you can do something there. Not so here, in this case. Therefore, it does not mean that I am unable to tell the answer, somebody else will tell. It is not like that. Actually, in its very inherent nature, this question is unanswerable. Follow it. Yes?
It's unqualified knowledge. Unqualified knowledge. Is it closer? Is it consciousness or is it thought?
The thought is qualified.
Thought is qualified.
It is unqualified. Only consciousness. Okay? Therefore, Polkinghorne makes very interesting three comments. I will come at the end. Okay? It becomes very strange. Your thinking thought process itself has to change in order to understand it. Just as, say for instance, you give up all your ideas of certainty, you include uncertainty, you include complementarity. Okay, that is, you are not compromising, you are compromising. The system has not compromised. The system is very adamant and stubborn. It commands you, if you want to measure me, you do only this much. Okay, therefore new ideas have entered. Exactly the same thing happened. That is why I want in particular the physics students to ponder over this. It will put you on a different track altogether. Till now we are going in bullock cart. Now you will have to fly. Okay? So now, I'm sure the discussion is going on now. Is highly useful and very potent. Okay. Incidentally, in Western thought process, what they do? They call it as free thinking. Okay. Free will is different. Free thinking. Okay. Free will you have, you can think of, because unbridled. Okay. That Shastra disapproves. There's no limit for it. It's only talking. There's no limit for it. Okay? Therefore, here, all discussion, any discussion, however profound it may be, ultimately it has to give a result which is also useful. It must be useful conclusion at the end of the discussion. Just because of free thinking, you write a story. You write a story, doesn't matter. So now, this consciousness is one. See? Oh, therefore, this is the second feature of the Tibetan. Since it can objectify anything different from it, it is only one. The proof is by electrode observer. Consciousness is one. Why it is one? Suppose it is two, then both are consciousnesses. One will become an observer to the other. Is it observed? You follow? Suppose consciousness are two. One consciousness makes another consciousness an observer, which is not consciousness.
Exactly.
There's no way I can have an ultimate observer. Exactly. If I have, it could be an observer. Exactly. Exactly. Therefore, this consciousness is by its nature, it is one. It's not more than that. Okay? That's what you see. What I am seeking to admire is very great scientist, Schrodinger. Consciousness is one, it cannot be two, it cannot be many. See, he is not having the proof, but somehow he gets it. Okay? Therefore, I have always been guided by these great people who teach us the process of thinking. Okay? Now see, ultimate cause is limitless. There is one more thing to be admitted. See, limitation comes in four ways: time, space, and through objects. Fourth will come. You can see easily. 38? Okay. See, by way of time, if something was there, it is not there afterwards. Okay. Therefore, it is limited in time. But here, because it is the ultimate cause, which is never indefinite, it is not produced at all, it stays always. Therefore, it is automatically unlimited in time. Next, in space. Now, it is the material cause for space also. That is, space is an effect of this material, of this cause. Therefore, certainly it pervades everywhere. Therefore, there is no limitation space-wise. Next thing. Object-wise. Object-wise means the chair is not table, table is not chair. Okay. Therefore, where there is table, there can't be chair. Where there is chair, there can't be table. Limitation is there. But for all central objects like this, which have limitation, this is the material cause. Therefore, it spans all limited objects. Therefore, There is no limitation there also. Aditya, you have been understood?
No, maybe you have already answered this, how does a changeless, how does a changeless, limitless and pure ability to think cause anything? How does it cause anything? If it doesn't go a change, if it is only an unqualified thought, or just the ability?
This is precisely what we discussed for 10 minutes.
Yeah, it will get productive.
No,
it
see,
is, you said that.
See, for you to get, I have not told anything. I told the inability to explain.
Yeah,
therefore, it's an unasked question I told. And he said, but I don't know, nobody knows, nobody can know it. Okay. Now as an example, I also told about quantum system. There also, you can't go on guessing on the basis of classical mechanics. You won't go anywhere. The logic there is different. Okay. Now, there is also a limitation with respect to the observer. You can show that figure next. See? Yes. Now there is a tripartite. What is this tripartite? The moment there is an observer, the observed, and the knowledge. There are three things. The observer, the knower, the known, and knowledge. Knower, known, knowledge are three. Okay. They are all different. Obviously different, they are all different. But you see, now, you take the known. The known, the ultimate cause spans all the known things. They are all because observables. Therefore, ultimate cause is spread all over that center. Now see knowledge. All knowledges are spanned by this. See, knowledge of the size, knowledge of the shape, knowledge. So knowledge is spanning everything, all qualified knowledges. Okay? Now take the knower. Knower's ability itself is a bit of consciousness. Therefore, the knower is also spanned by this. Is it all right? I told you, what exactly is consciousness? Consciousness here, it is the bit of consciousness, it is my ability. It is your ability, ability. In every body that this question was raised, okay? Body wise, if you can see, it is divided. Your ability there, your ability there. Therefore, it spans all the abilities. Therefore, all the observers are also spanned. Therefore, though there is a tripartite division, in the case of knower, known, and the knowledge, all the three sectors are spanned by the ultimate cause. Therefore, it is limitless there also. So what does it show? It shows that there is absolutely no type of, no sort of limitation anywhere. Therefore, it is limitless. Okay. No question comes. But certainly effect is there, cause is there. Effect and cause, are they not bringing a division? Understand the question? Is it not giving a limitation? Cause is cause, effect is effect? No. Because the effect is nothing but cause. Only in an appearance. All the isomers are only the given set of five molecules, all have five atoms. Is it not so? Therefore, molecule is not at all different from this. Therefore, there is no division between molecule and the atoms. There is no division. You can't think of a division between isomers and the corresponding atoms. Is it clear? Therefore, even when you are talking of effect and cause, there is no division there, there is no limitation there. What is happening is, I look at a certain curve there, and with reference to it, I call it as a cause. With reference to juxtaposition, I call it a cause. There is a different property, I recognize it. But stuff-wise, it is only the cause. Therefore, the cause spans the effect. There is no limitation there also. Another question arises. How can the negation of all the features help us in recognizing the ultimate cause? The question is very elaborately discussed. See, you say it has no features at all. If it has no features, what is the validity of your statement? How do you conclude? It is there. You are simply making a statement. How does your statement get its validity? Okay? Therefore, the question, how can the negation of all the reasons help us in recognizing the ultimate cause? It is in this way. Though it is present in the universe we are looking at, that it is present is obvious. Remember, if you believe in the existence of the world, then automatically you have to believe in the ultimate cause. Because its existence is assured only by this. Do you remember the statement? See, the existence of the molecule is assured by the atom. The existence of the atom is assured by the nucleus. Its existence is assured by quarks. Therefore, the existence of all these ultimate causes, anti-one, is assured only by the ultimate cause. Therefore, if you believe that the world exists, this must also be existing. There is no doubt about that. Okay? But we are looking, therefore it is there. But we are unable to recognize it since our attention is fixed on the features of the world, which we are accustomed to. The negation is intended to help us to withdraw our mind from this wrong attention. Why is it told? It is told, don't keep your attention on this, it is not this, leave it. Some of you will have heard this statement, neti neti. What is neti neti means? Not this, not this, not this. Let me repeat it. I want to recognize the ultimate cause. Otherwise it will be an empty statement. Okay. How to recognize it? I am sure it is there. Therefore, I should be able to recognize it. How? See, withdraw your attention from all things that you know, from everything that you know, withdraw your attention. Then you will automatically see it. This is completely described in the next chapter. So, I don't go into details just now. This withdrawal is not easy, it is very tough. However, one succeeds in this, it will be recognized automatically. Now see, these three characteristics, namely, unchangeability, limitlessness, and consciousness, these three are mutually independent. You know how it is described? It's described like this. Exactly as it says. What are these three axes? They are mutually independent. In other words, each restricts the other two, not to enter into its arena. Each axis, the x-axis, does not allow y-axis to come anywhere near it. It commands. And it is also commanded. It is commanded by others, and it commands the other two. Niyamya niyamaka. So this is called mutual independence. Okay? Therefore, it is mutually independent. Okay? Like the three coordinate axes, which define the position of a classical particle uniquely in space. It means that each characteristic is separately and directly connected with the ultimate cause. That is to say, ultimate cause is changes, ultimate cause is consciousness, ultimate cause is limitless. All the three, you can't give up even one, you have to use all the three. This is because, besides the ultimate cause, there is at least one observable satisfying each of the three characteristics. See the figure? The figure, take changelessness. Inertia is also changeless because it is not produced. Take limitlessness, ether is also limitless. Take qualified knowledge, that is also knowledge. But all the three are satisfied only by the ultimate cause. Therefore, the ultimate cause lies at the origin. Can you show the corresponding figure for observables? Yes? Section 33B figure? 33. Actually, they are reciprocal. There, only central observables are coming here, ultimate causes come to the origin. Right? Therefore, just these two figures, if you simply delve deeply on that, I am sure you will get many mysteries. Okay? Now you see. See, the world is also existing. All the other things are existing. There is no doubt about that. Okay? No one is non-existing. Everything is existing. Ultimate cause is also existing. What is the difference? The difference is everything else existing may go. Ultimate cause will survive. This is the only thing which survives. What does that mean? It means the whole world, it is getting, they are getting their existence only due to the presence of the ultimate cause. That is, they owe their existence to ultimate cause. Okay? They actually will never show that the ultimate cause is absolutely existent. In what sense? In the sense that everything appears, stays for a short time or a long time, and then disappears. Whereas the only unchanging that exists always, everywhere, is the ultimate cause. So it is described as absolutely existent or absolutely real. Its meaning is revealed in the following way. We know that the existence of an object depends only on the existence of its constituent molecules, their existence and inserts of constituent atoms, and so on. Conversely, when the object is cut into pieces, it is lost, but its molecules remain. And the molecules are similarly large, their atoms remain, and so on. So ultimately, something must remain when all the intimate causes are lost. It has to be indestructible. Suppose no such constant thing exists, then neither the intimate cause nor the object can come to existence. The whole world will be simply vacuum if it is not there. Since we know that the object and its intimate causes are existing, an indestructible cause does exist, and that is the ultimate cause by definition. So, the only thing, now it's assurance in there. It exists, is assured. So, the only thing to be checked is whether that indestructible cause is the ultimate cause we have derived about or not. Number one, we have to check it. Now, how to check it? We have to check the existence of the ultimate cause. It is there, it is definite. Therefore, it must be experienceable, it must come to, we must come to know it. Are you following me? Therefore, where do we come to know it? When? The complete details, I will take it up later. It comes into experience during deep sleep. Deep sleep is a positive experience. Okay. Then how it comes? You check there in your experience. For these three features? Now see. See. Oh, this ultimate cause exists. It has to exist. Okay. And now, if we are not able to know it at all, recognize it at all, then it's empty talk. There's no use. Talking about it. It has to come to experience. Therefore, where is it coming to experience? Is the question. Okay. Now see, you are experiencing three states: wakeful state, dream state, and deep sleep. Now, in the first two states, you are seeing only. We are experiencing only changes, and you are experiencing only knowledges, qualified knowledges. Okay. Now see deep sleep. There, nothing is changing. There is no change there. I have slept in childhood, boyhood, youth, older, the same thing. Man, woman, the same thing. Eunuch, same thing. Rich man, same thing. Poor man, same thing. Therefore, there is no change in it. No change. Let's see. There is also limitlessness. See, we have discussed limitlessness. A limit comes from four points of view: time-wise, space-wise, object-wise, and this tripartite-wise. Now, time is not there, space is not there, objects are not there. These three dimensions are also not there. No, no real, no knowledge, nowhere, nothing is there. There is no nowhere, remember that. Nowhere means what? Knowing something separate. Nowhere is there. He is not knowing anything separately. And he is himself a bit of consciousness. Therefore, what we are experiencing there is precisely the ultimate cause. Yeah? No, no. If something is there, it has to be experienced. Suppose it cannot be experienced, I don't believe its existence. Is it not there? See, suppose somebody says it is there. Where is it? Show me. Did you say you are not convinced? That's what I say. Whether this is also unexperienceable? See, if it is not experienceable, then it is not real. You can't prove its existence. Say, when you say it is unexperienceable, how do you say it exists? See, suppose you simply make a statement, you can't experience it, it is there. Means it is just free thinking, for example. What?
The ultimate cause, you prove that it exists.
Yes, you have proved it is existing. You are my proof, very wrong. I might have committed a mistake there. Therefore, it's proof unless I experience it, I can't prove it. I can't believe its existence. I have proved. The proof is correct. Okay. When do I say correct? After I have experienced it.
Yes, it is all correct, but how do you conclude that it should be experienceable? I
don't understand. No. But you understand this, remember this center. If it is not experienceable, then you can't assure that it is there. You may prove it brilliantly. Your ability to prove is not questioned here. Whatever your ability, if you can't experience it, I don't believe its existence. I think this statement every scientist agrees. Yes?
The deep sleep state is changeless and limitless.
Yeah.
What is the mechanism through which I came out of it?
This is a slightly different question. But first let us complete this discussion. Now, limitlessness, it is chakra. No change, it is chakra. There is some question about consciousness. Is consciousness there or not? How can I say there is consciousness? Okay. Now remember, consciousness must be there because after getting up, you don't say that you are not there. See, let me repeat the sentence. In deep sleep, there is no indication for the existence of anything. Is it right? There are no indications. But I am there. That I am there, I know. I don't need proof. there in deep sleep. Does not need a proof. It is there. I am there. Why am I there? Because I was there as consciousness only. And consciousness is myself. Therefore I was there. Have you known this? Have you understood this? See, suppose there were no consciousness at all. How would I recognize that I existed there? It is being myself. I know myself. I am there. And I am consciousness. Therefore, it is actually verified. But now, there are very, very intricate questions in this connection. All these questions will be taken up in the next chapter. Okay? Now, if you have got any questions, tell me. Did you ask something?
Yes.
His question is the following. The question is, there is no connection at all. Okay. How do I go there? How do I come out? That's the question. Is it right? A very good question. Very interesting. See carefully. You know that the same state, more intensely, intensively, okay, it takes place during surgery, during
anesthesia.
It happens. Okay. Exactly the same thing happens in deep sleep. What is this? Is the following. The mind is functional. These are all, it's not connected to the main problem here. But when I question the reasons, answer must be given. Okay? The mind is working. It also gets tired. Therefore, there is an arrangement in the system to give rest. During waking and dreams, oxygen is being supplied to the brain. Right? What happens during deep sleep is the following. You know, oxygen supply is made by the pranas. There are five pranas. Perhaps you have heard of them. Prana, apana, vyana, samana, udana. Okay. Prana is breathing out. Apana is breathing in. Vyana is holding the breath. Samana is digestion and distribution. Udana is the one which acts during this time. It cuts off the supply of oxygen to the mind. To the brain. Are you understanding it? The Udana Vayu has one role daily. It cuts off the oxygen supply to the brain. Okay. Now, once again, when it starts supplying, you wake up. Okay. Therefore, it is the role of Udana Vayu. In Western medical science, for respiration they take only these four. Prana, Apana, Vyana, Samana. But they don't consider this Udana because they don't know. These are some of the things one should note. Why it is in between is not scientists can get lots of problems. Lots of problems. Supply of oxygen is reduced by another way. Okay. Therefore, that is the process. So mind activates and deactivates. So when vacuum, what is happening is, I am as I am. When the mind is activated, I say I am awake, I am dreaming. When it's cold, I say I am sleeping. That's all. So this is a machine in which these things are happening. And as a knower, I am knowing all these things. See, in fact, Shastra gives a caution at this stage.
Something like cut off from the experience. Actually, I will tell you.
See, it could be right or wrong. I will explain it. Sometimes we may mistake, we will have gone to sleep, but we will not be doing it. That could be there. Okay, that is why Shastra tells specifically, be careful. Don't mistake for this. It's also true. Okay. But it may also get cut off. Really, it get cut off. Then it is something very new. Okay. Now, that's a different state altogether. Okay? That is also a state, mental state, in which it is not thinking. Okay? So, we can stop here for that. Now, absolute existence was discussed. The only absolute existence is this. I'll talk about conservation of existence later on. Bringing conservation of laws. Okay? We will take it up at the end. Now here at this stage, we consider it necessary to add an explanatory note to remove a widely spread wrong notion that the absolute reality of the ultimate cause propounded by Vedanta implies that the world is an illusion. This question is raised by Polkinghorn and he simply discards it. No, we don't agree. Nobody will agree with it. Okay? So I repeat, it is an absurd statement to say that the world is an illusion, deserving outright rejection. Not correct. The stand of Vedanta is opposite to this. Anything validated by any of the four means of direct perception, inference, analogy and presumption, has reality. It has reality. According to this unambiguous meaning of reality, the world does exist. Remember, I am quoting Upanishads. Not simply statements. Upanishads tell this. People transact with it. A transactable entity cannot be unsubstantial. Dehidharatmakam bhutam kinchit vyavahara yukam pute. Without substance, you can't do a transaction. Therefore, it must be there. But as long as it exists, what are these other things? It owes its existence to the absolute, really, real ultimate cause veiled in it. It's existing because the cause is in it. Okay? Therefore, it has transactional reality. the world as transactional reality. You can transact with it. It does not have its own independent reality. Independent reality is called transcendental reality. Okay. It is just like the transactional reality of an ice block, depending on the invisible H2O molecules in it. In this example, the reality of H2O molecules stands in the place of absolute reality. Okay. Another question. If so, which is the one that Vedanta refers to as unreal? The answer is obtainable through the same example. The ice blocks are solid and hydrogen oxygen are gases. So an ignorant person would understand the ice block is different from H2O molecules. The ice block of his understanding is illusory. What he has understood is an illusion. There is nothing like an illusory object in front. He has got illusion in his mind. That is all. Okay. The ice block of his understanding is illusory. Similarly, thinking that the world is independent of the ultimate cause is also an ignorant imagination. The world understood in that way is illusory, not the world which is inseparable from the ultimate cause. This is also in Upanishad. Remember. Not only this much, further, even the mirage is not non-existent. It has apparent reality. When the mirage is mistaken for water, that water is plain illusion, not the mirage. We have discussed it. So, three realities are discussed. Transcendental reality of the ultimate cause, transactional reality of the world, and apparent reality of the mirage. When the mirage is real, this is completely discussed in Taittiriya Upanishad. Okay. That's how many times I feel, because you will have heard all sorts of funny statements in Vedanta, it puts you off as a scientist. Arey, what is this all they are talking about, sir? It doesn't make sense at all. You cannot find one sentence as a scientist which you can find fault with. It is so precise. Okay? The mirage is apparently real, since it is based on the transactional reality of the heated ground. It can be photographed. The apparent reality is based on transactional reality is based on absolute reality. And there is nothing unreal or unsubstantial anywhere at any time according to Vedanta. This is the actual sentence of Bhashyakara. The exact sentence I am repeating. There is nothing like unreal anywhere. Okay? Only in the imagination people think wrongly. That is there. And what they think is an illusion. Now, we'll stop here for a few minutes if you have any discussion we can carry. Yes, yes?
Changelessness and the attributes of the ultimate cause, changelessness, consciousness and limitlessness. The first two I can relate, can I relate them to Sat, Chit and is the third Anand?
No. Ananda, don't worry about it. Ananda will not come here. We'll talk later. Necessary. This is Satya Jnana Ananda. Ananda doesn't come here. Yes?
When we speak of then we refer to the process of meditating.
Process of?
Meditating. Not this, not this. So does it, is it equivalent to saying that the mind is completely still?
See, When you say not this, not this, what exactly it means is, whatever is graspable by the mind is not this.
That's very correct. Then you know the property of the molecule.
That is, you know the nucleus not by these reactions. You know it only by alpha scattering. Is it or is it not? Therefore, you are entering into energy level, another energy level altogether. That, you see, if you notice, from outside, you can't see inside. From inside, you can see outside. If you are perfectly, have perfect knowledge of the system of atoms, then you can talk freely about molecules. Yes?
The last section that you discussed on reality, you mentioned that these are discussed in Kaittiriya.
Yes.
Also by Shankara, Acharya Shankara.
Yes. Yes.
So from all this discussion, can you conclude that the ultimate cause cannot be observable, but can be experienced?
Can be experienced.
Can be experienced. Yes.
Exactly. It can be experienced. In fact, even experiences, I shouldn't disagree, is it not so? I will have to bring in a lot of quantum theory in between and show that it's possible only in this way. We'll take up the discussion from tomorrow. Yes?
Swamiji, the last thing, there is nothing unreal
about it. There is state of
consciousness, like what happens, the state of death.
See, death is a very different thing. Now it takes a lot of time to, okay, all the components in the subtle body, they have to be withdrawn. Okay, there's a very different type of discipline. It takes not less than 2 hours to explain it. Therefore, we'll postpone it. The next chapter, we actually discuss how, from the ultimate cause, the whole of creation takes place. It involves quantum levels only. That involves quantum levels even in Vedanta. Okay. That all that are implied in the statements of Upanishads. All that I will bring it.